Amen. I'd like to welcome you today on behalf of June and the family to this memorial service for John Partridge. And so let's have a word of prayer to begin, and then some of the family members are going to be sharing with us today. So, Lord, here we are today, and Lord, we want to thank you for John's life. We want to thank you for the wonderful saving work that you did in his life. His testimony, his legacy, we give you thanks for that today. And Lord, we do pray for family. We pray for loved ones. We pray for those who are even now missing him. Lord, that they would be comforted and blessed and encouraged and reminded of the great promises of heaven and the fact that John has just really gone ahead of us into your kingdom. Thank you, Lord, that he's there, that he's safe, he's sound, he's healed, he's whole. Lord, we give you praise for that today. So as we take this time to remember him and to honor you, we pray that you would bless. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Well, you can be seated. I'm going to introduce some of the family members who are going to come up and share some things with us. But before I do that, I just want to say a personal word. I never really met John. One very, very brief moment of seeing him just about a week before he passed away. But I feel like I kind of knew him indirectly because my wife did an interview with June, and she's had a fondness for June for quite some time. And she told me the entire story of their lives. It was like I could visualize the whole thing as she sat and told me the story. So I feel like, in some ways, I know John, even though I never really met him. And a wonderful story indeed, a wonderful testimony indeed, John's life and June's life together. So I'm thankful to be here today and to be part of this celebration. So at this point, I'm going to ask the children of John, Kate, Samantha, and Simon, to come up. And each of them are going to take a moment, and they're going to share some thoughts today.
Yes, just go in the order that you feel comfortable.
Sure.
Okay.
It seems odd to be here, sitting in the rows. I wrote this note, which seems weak. As a kid, I had, like my kids, no appreciation much of the time that my dad created to be with me, to be with us as a family. I see that now, having my own kids, working, how difficult it is to make time to be with your children, how important it is to create that time. And it's difficult. And my dad succeeded. He was a hard worker. I always remember him working nights, working lots of different times to make ends meet as a family. So reflecting back, I'm very respectful of my father, something that I probably wasn't as a teenager. But I am grateful to my father for being there for me, being there for my family, being there for my mom. Early memories, having my own children, unfortunately, my memories and my hair, like my dad, has disappeared. So my memories, my early memories, I remember him taking me to the local park and me always nagging him to play soccer with me. And I remember us going on the Ashdown Forest and flying kites, which most of them ended broken by the time we flew them. Dad somewhat insisted on getting high-end flights, unlike the little kids' flights, or kites, I should say. And we ended up just crashing them into the ground all the time. It seemed pretty cool at the time, to be honest. I remember him being interested in my interests, the trains that he helped me create in my room, the massive train layout that I had, filled most of my childhood memories of building and creating train sets. I'm grateful too of a faithful husband he was to my mum. Trends nowadays are not for marriage to last decades. Sometimes they only last years. I can be guilty of that fact, but I'm thankful of a father who stood by my mum through the thick and thin, and my mum standing by my father through the good and the bad. As I got older, I remember my dad still being there for me. I remember an instance of a bully chasing me home from school. I went to a school that was combined with lots of young and older kids, and I remember a bully picking on me. Seemed frequently, I'm sure it was infrequently, but my dad in his usual fashion sorting him out, and I never got bullied again. So, I mean, it's good to have a father who stands by you, understands your needs. My father also was instrumental in my teenage years, much to my mum's dismay. I wrote dismay, but I'm sure it was disgust of going 50-50 with my first motorcycle when I was 16. How happy I was to have a bike, like my dad who had a bike when he was younger. And today I still love bikes, and I know where that came from. He was instrumental in my first job, getting me an apprenticeship in London, setting me up for life, really. So I thank God for my parents. Thank God for being instrumental in my dad's life, knowing that my dad went to heaven, knowing that I will see him again. And I'm always going to love him. And I miss him.
Well, we have family all over the world. I know a few of you were confused this morning. Thought that my sister here was Mum's sister from Spain. That's not the case. But this is Katie. This is my sister. She's come the furthest. She came from England, arrived last night. So,
did.
Yeah. Mum's asked me to read something quick from Chris. Christine is John's sister. We all called her Chris. I know it's a little confusing, but she's in England. She wrote a note, which I'm going to read quick. And she says, "Hi, everyone. My name is Chris Appleton, and I'd like to share a few memories of my big brother, John. He was 3 years older than me. We lived in London when we were very young and had a happy childhood, even though in our early years the Second World War was going on. Mum and Dad grew up during the Blitz, but... So some nights were spent in a half-underground Anderson shelter, which those of you that are World War II buffs know it's like a solid metal bunny cage that you can get in and it's supposed to protect you from bombs. And often our mother and our father had to get in there with us too. John was in the army and he was abroad a lot. And this was our back garden. I don't know if she meant the Anderson shelter filled the whole garden or if she was being metaphorical, but John used to send me on errands for a few pennies to add to my pocket money when I was little. And he always asked me to get him cherries, but it was winter and he knew that our local shop only sold them in the summer. So he had a very dry sense of humor. He loved the outdoor life, and he never seemed to lose his tan. Several years after marrying June, they moved to America, and the rheumatism in his shoulders disappeared after 3 weeks. As well as being a dad, granddad, and great-grandfather, and we do have a little squirt, that's my grandson, William. He's a year, but he's not here, since he'd just be tearing all over the place. He was also an uncle to three, a great-uncle to four, and most recently, a great-great-uncle to two lovely girls. I didn't know that one. I'm so sorry he is no longer with us. God bless John. Love from your sister Chris and my family. So that was from Auntie Chris. All righty. I've got a verse I want to read. It's 2 Corinthians. I'm going to read it. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, 1 and 2. For we know that if our earthly house, this tent, is destroyed, we have a building from God, a house not made with hands, and eternal in the heavens. For in this we groan, earnestly desiring to be clothed with our habitation, which is from heaven. And I've written that one of my earliest memories is riding high on my dad's shoulders and hanging onto his ears as he strolled along, because he never had any hair. Well, I don't remember. He was tall, bronzed, athletic, and he was strong and determined. And when he put his mind to a task, nothing could deter him. When I was a teenager, Dad walked into the kitchen one day, and he announced that he'd purchased a tent. I can still remember Mum's face. So we could go camping in the summer. It was an enormous orange tent. It was big enough for several refugee families, in fact. He spent a good week in the back garden with piles of poles and orange canvas, figuring out how to erect it. It took him a while. Later that summer, my brother and I arrived with my dad, and we were ahead of the rest of the family. We were going in convoy, I think, in several cars. So Simon, my dad, and I arrived at the campground first. And Dad, by this time, had perfected his tenting technique. So he swiftly erected the big orange tent, and I can remember how proud he looked. And then he hollered, "Kids, get the sleeping bags." And that's when we discovered he'd forgotten all the bedding, and Mum was about to arrive. Oh, boy. His face changed a bit. In 1984, Mum and I went up to the American Embassy in London to apply for a visitor's visa for me. A Christian family in Newport Beach had invited me to stay for the whole summer and help with their three kids. I knew this was a door that God was opening for me. So I was devastated when the embassy refused me a visa. Mum and I came back on the coach, and I just think I cried the whole way. But Dad wasn't going to take no for an answer. So he accompanied me back to London, up to the US Embassy, and he argued my case with the lady behind the little glass window, I can still remember. She was shaking her head. No, 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 no. I think she finally got fed up with him because she stamped my passport. And the rest is history, so to speak. It's difficult to watch someone you love, especially someone so strong and determined, slowly waste away and die. Mum and I got to see that because I've been living with my folks for a couple of years. In the end, Mum and I held his hand, and I prayed. I know Mum was praying too, but I prayed that God would stop his strong heart from beating and take him to heaven where there's no pain, there's no suffering, there's no cancer, and God did. And Mum and I were left with an empty shell, a bodily tent that had been vacated. I imagine right now Dad is somewhere beside the glassy sea, basking in the eternal sunshine of God's light. He always loved the beach. Love, Mance.
Right, my turn. Found out when I arrived can't remember what time I got in now, at John Wayne Airport, that I was going to give a speech this morning. Well, just a little tribute to my dad. And I thought, wow, I didn't want to write anything down, so, because I felt it'd be more spontaneous to talk to you guys about my father and my father's character, really, I guess. So I was praying about it last night and a little bit this morning. I asked God what I could say about my dad. Samantha and Simon have said a lot about the way he was and some of the memories. And something my mum said to me, she said that a good friend of ours had said that Dad was a man of integrity. And I thought, yeah, he was. He was a man of integrity. However, he didn't used to be. And I thought it might be a little bit fun to tell you about one story that maybe my brother and sister don't know about. I know Mum does, because I've mentioned it to her. But isn't God great when he changes characters? Because my dad was a little bit naughty, I have to say, when I was little. He was quite mischievous. And I kind of liked that in a little way at the time. And I was very fortunate that my dad saw me as the walking companion, I guess. I didn't always want to go, I have to say, but he loved going for walks with whatever dog we had at the time and used to literally sometimes drag me out the door. And I remember on one occasion we had our Cocker Spaniel with us. Slightly neurotic, but great fun, and used to romp around and run away and all that sort of thing. So off we set, and we didn't go on our normal walk that day. We went somewhere new, and I remember we got to this particular field and crossed the field, and then we got to this huge barbed wire gate with the private property, enter at your own risk, and I thought, Dad's going to go in. Yep, sure thing. He went in and dragged me with him, and I thought, I'm going to guess around 13, maybe 14. I was certainly in my teens. And at that stage where, you know, not that confident, you know, of doing something that you shouldn't really be doing, well, certainly for me, I felt quite uncomfortable. But anyway, we wandered in, and after about 20 minutes, we lost the dog. Don't know where she went, and I still don't know to this day where she went for that time. And in the next minute, I could hear this, get out of my garden, or whatever it was, get out of my land, and loads of shouting and loads of guns going off in the air. And I'm looking at my dad, and he's saying, oh, don't worry, it'll be fine. And I'm thinking, no, it won't. It won't be fine. But anyway, we were calling the dog, and I was getting more and more upset and just crying and all sorts of things. I can remember it very, very well. And no sign of the dog and loads of guns going off. And you've shot the dog, Dad. And I was, no, it'll be fine, it'll be fine. And then I can remember this great big guy storming towards us with this sort of big shotgun thing slung over his shoulder, dog running behind him, and saying, what are you doing on my land? And Dad kind of said, really sorry, and scuttled off with me in tow, dog in tow. I can remember it to this day, and that's just one of many stories I could tell you. I have very fond memories, really, because if you compare how he used to be to what man he became, I mean, for me, the change over someone when God intervenes, God meets you. I won't bore you with all the other stories. I mean, for me, early memories are my dad taught me to ride a bike. He taught me to dive. He taught me an awful lot. And I will honestly say that I wouldn't have joined the forces without the intervention of both parents. I was able to stand on my own two feet. They brought me up fairly strictly, but I reap the benefits. I reap the benefits now. And I just stand in awe of how God can change people's characters. My dad was not an honest man at that stage, but he became a man of integrity, a man after God's heart, and he knew he was saved. And I know that, and we all know that here. And for me, that is such a blessing that he is now in heaven. He goes before us. And as he said to Mom, he stands and waits for you. Thank you.
Thank you, each of you. Rachel and Jonathan are John's grandchildren, and they're going to speak a few words. Yeah.
Okay, I'm first. Well, hello, I'm Rachel. I was John's granddaughter, and I am also the mother of William, his great-grandchild. And I really wanted to share about my granddad's sense of humor. He had a great and wicked sense of humor. And I think I remember in my teenage years, my granddad and I would do battles at Christmas on who would have the worst gift. And it all started when I think I was 13. For Christmas, he gave me a giant ketchup bottle, literally this big, this wide, and then a pack of tape, packing, like, you know, just tape. And he said, because you use mine too much. So, and after that, it was just a battle every year. And next year, I got him a mayonnaise, but it was actually a particular mayonnaise that looked like a tube, so it fit into his favorite candy tube. So I handed that to him, and I said, here you go, I got your candy. And he knew right away what I had done, because he felt the weight. And he said, too heavy. And he refused to open it, because he knew it was a trick. But I think the next year was the most memorable, because he came up to me and handed me a Nordstrom's box. And I was thrilled. I was excited. Oh, what did he get me? Something designer. I know it's something designer, something expensive. And I opened it up, and he had taped rocks inside. And there was a tape in there, and it said, this is your heritage. And it wasn't labeled. He didn't tell me what it was. And I popped it into the tape player, and it was Chaz and Dave. God. Yeah. I bet they don't. Okay. Chaz and Dave. Chaz and Dave, they're kind of... Well, I actually had to go back on YouTube to listen, because I don't know where the tape went. And Chaz and Dave was a very crude, pretty much Cockney group. And I just a brief, the song was about how ladies of London are pretty much more busty than anybody else. Don't know how that relates to my heritage personally, but I also remember talking to my granddad a lot, always in the garden. And I would ask him silly things, like, because I've always really been into clothes and fashion, so I would show up in like a skirt up to about mid-thigh, and I would say, what do you think of my new skirt? And he goes, looks like a napkin. And I think another question I asked him, I was really young, I asked him, I had just got my first hamster, and I said, do hamsters make noise? And he said, step on it and find out. But from my granddad, that's what I remember most about him, his good sense of humor. And ever since he passed away, just everyone I meet, even a stranger, I tell them a story about him, and they just crack up, and they go, he was an amazing person. really meant a lot to you. He still means a lot to me. And that's what I have to share.
Good job, Rachel.
Okay.
Right. Is this working? Oh, it's too loud. Sorry. I have to say that I did have some initial problems writing this speech because obviously I knew that the people were actually mostly going to talk about my grandfather. Mostly it's just that they knew him, the things that he did, but something wrong? Oh, sorry, this is the first time I've used like a mic. So I had some difficulty writing it because I eventually just decided to just talk about the things that sort of helped define him, sort of like his... the things that made his character, he made him so whimsical and the person that he was, but those are the things that I pretty much just remember the most about my grandfather, especially because they really helps to define his character and understand who he was, because if you were to meet him in real life like I did, you would know that he didn't say a lot. He was very stoic in what he did. And if he did say anything, he actually, it was mainly something, he was either just to be very honest or just to speak about anything worth speaking about. But, like, he's probably the person I remember most when I was a child growing up. Yeah, a lot of people don't remember a lot of their memories when they're very young. But though it's sort of as blurry to me, I definitely can remember the outline of my grandfather. And a picture that my mother gave me of him recently just shows with me on his lap as a baby and him smiling. He really enjoyed having me around. But there was one memory in particular that I can remember the most vividly about my grandfather, and that he was always so full of surprises that because we live in California, we live such in close proximity to the beach. He and Grandma would always take me and my sister to the beach, specifically up to Crystal Cove. And I remember on this one trip in particular, after we had gotten done eating a picnic, my grandfather, he usually would just sit around, he would probably read or just eat. But on this case, he actually surprised me, actually got up. And I don't remember what he said exactly, but I seem to remember it's something about the ocean. So I asked my grandma, or was it my mom? I think it was both. But I asked them where he was going, and they just said, he's going surfing. And yet he was around his late 40s, no, 50s around his time. And I can actually remember him eventually a couple minutes later. He's out on the ocean, and he's literally catching a wave. And he's actually passing, and he's doing it really well. I didn't see him fall. And he was surfing just as well as the younger people who were also out there. And he was just full of surprises like that. And, of course, there were some other very strange quirks about him that actually made him very humorous, like his very strange taste of films. He thought Sea Spot Run was the pinnacle of filmmaking. And it's a film... to describe it, it's sort of the main focus is that comedian David Arquette is being terrorized by this very smart FBI dog. And yeah, I still remember one time, like, he even thought that he didn't even like The Manchurian Candidate with Frank Sinatra, a film that's considered the pinnacle of filmmaking and political thrillers. Compared to that, apparently, he thought Sea Spot Run was like the Citizen Kane of movies. But there's some other quirks as well. He loved anchovies on his pizza. The traits that really defined him to me was his willingness to help. I think we all know here he was very altruistic. He loved to help people out, and whenever he could, he actually helped me particularly to move into my father's house for a while. I've since moved out, but it was accomplished a lot thanks to the use of his truck, and I'm very thankful to him for that. But the thing that I admired most about him was his pride. Whenever he set his mind to something, he always did it, and both behaviorally and in his beliefs. Like when he was told to retire by the federal government because he'd reached the age of retirement, he actually just said, "Nah, I'm not going to do that." And then seasonally, he worked as a trolley driver for the Sawdust Film Festival. When he was told to change his diet, he still ate as though he were a young man. But it was unfortunately, as we all know, his pride, I think, that unfortunately pretty much just kneecapped him. He smoked ever since he was very young. He was pretty much just a lifetime smoker. But to his credit, though, he actually began to try and kick the habit. I think it, by the time I ever sniff, I think he was down to nicotine patches and gum. And I think you ought to forgive me if I'm wrong about this, Grandma, if I don't remember. Well, I think he was actually off the patches by the time he was diagnosed, because it was too late, unfortunately. And even then, I think his pride actually told him, he thought that he was fine. But there was one incident, though, that told me that I think in this he was actually faltering as well. Like, on one, I often make regular trips to see my grandparents, and we often, Granddad and I never talked a lot. It was usually just a quick, "Oh, hello, John, how are you?" "I'm fine." And he would go back to his book. That was usually the typical conversation that we had. And I think that's why he enjoyed having me over. I didn't really bug him with too much talking. But on this trip, in particular, I gave my customary, "Hello, John, how are you doing?" He was in the backyard in his garden reading. And a couple minutes in, he actually surprised me. He started talking to me. He asked how my job was and how I was doing with the new room. It even got to a point where I was telling my plans to like eventually save up for a little moped scooter. Those are coming in at the moment. But yeah, it really surprised me. But that was unfortunately the last long conversation that we had. And I saw him a couple weeks later. And when I saw him, it was just, he was so thin. Yeah, I couldn't believe that it was him. And I just saw in his eyes that he really didn't want to see me like that. Yeah, and I could just tell. He was just telling me, "Please, don't stay here that long." And I just respected him. And I just said, "Hi, John, I just wanted to come and say hi, but I don't want to disturb you that long, so I'll let you get back to sleep." A couple of days later, he was gone, too. It was ironic, too, since my parents had actually just taken me out. No, my stepmom and my father had taken me out for birthday lunch, and a few hours later, my mom called and said that he died at the age of 78. And I cried a little, but obviously when I just remembered that the good things that he did in this life, I just knew that he was in a good place, and I was happy to know that he died peacefully. But I'm way past the 5-minute mark here, I know, but I really just want to get all I have to say about him out, I won't get penalized, but I have to say this, but I really don't have the words to really describe how much I'm going to miss him. And I'm going to miss his rare smiles that reflected the enjoyment of life he had. And I'm especially going to miss coming over to Grandma's now, and I'm really going to miss seeing him on the porch, either reading the Orange County Register or reading one of his other books, and me being constantly amazed, like, "Whoa, weren't you just reading another book a week before? And a new one, huh? No, neat." The best way that I think I can end this speech is by saying that my love for him and respect will always be there, even after he's gone. And I can think of no better way to honor him than that. And if Dante, in his book, The Divine Comedy, if his idea of paradise is to be taken true, or it does turn out to be real, then I think that my grandfather has attained the highest possible circle. Goodbye, John. Thank you for being such a good friend and a grandfather to me and my sister.
The way you wear your hat, the way you sip your tea, the memory of all that. No, no, they can't take that away from me. The way your smile just beams, the way you sing off key, the way you haunt my dreams. can't take that away from me. We may never, never meet again on the bumpy road to love. Still, I'll always, always keep the memory of the way you hold your knife, the way we dance till three, the way you've changed.
The way you wear your hat, the way you sip your tea.